Hey y'all, Coach Unify here, talking about the evenings and the mornings and when our day is actually supposed to start. Now, you may have seen other videos we've done on this subject. This all reminds me of the days in which I was in basic training and we were having tracer round training. Now, a tracer round is something that they put in the rifle in order so they can see where the bullets go at night. The thing about it, they're made out of something that's actually extremely flammable. And when we were in tracer round training, some of us got the idea to actually shoot those tracer rounds in a certain place that created a fire. Being that it was nighttime, they couldn't see which one of us was actually doing it, and I participated as well. What we would do is just shoot the tracer rounds over in a certain corner of the field that kept catching on fire. And the range officials would have to stop the training and go and put out the fire and would start the training again, and we would shoot them back over there and would start a fire again. So this is kind of what's going on when it comes to the subject on when the day starts, when the month starts, and when the year starts. There are individuals out here not thinking about their actions and the consequences of their actions, and they'll put out videos with incorrect information, not thinking that if nobody goes over and puts that fire out, it could start a big, huge forest fire that could actually get out of control. Just like today, I watched a video from one of my fellow YouTubers who actually discredited the entire Book of Jubilees because it didn't agree with what he thought. He found in the Book of Jubilees in chapter 5 and verse 23, where it's talking about Noah and his ark and how the Lord closed up the ark on the evening of the 17th day of the month. Looking at that one verse from the Book of Jubilees, he decided that the entire Book of Jubilees was leavened and therefore should not be considered scriptural text. In other words, because this one verse disagrees with his idea of when the day is actually supposed to start, he's not only thrown the whole book out of his library, but he's gone as far as to make a video to convince the rest of us that we shouldn't follow this vital information either. The Book of Jubilees is extremely important, as it is the only book that actually gives us the Jubilee counts and the years and the weeks from Adam all the way up through the crossing of the River Jordan. If we ever want to understand when the Jubilees are in our current lives, we're going to have the Book of Jubilees to help us. It is the only book that offers us any hint on when the Jubilees are to fall. And without it, we will never know when the correct Jubilee year is. So to toss it out is serious folly. But anyway, when it comes to people who try to discredit the Bible, just like the people who tried to add credibility to the Bible, they're actually both going to be correct. The person who's trying to prove that the scripture is accurate, like on this channel, they're going to be proven right. But on the other channels that try to prove that the scripture is not accurate, they're actually going to be proven right too. That's what 2 Thessalonians in chapter 2 is talking about when it says that God shall send strong delusion. This strong delusion is reserved for those who love not the truth that's only found in the scripture. In other words, people who are working so hard to take the credibility away from the scripture and seek out lies will actually find them. Turns out our Father is going to send them lies that they might be damned who believe not the truth of the scripture. So when anybody comes in and tries to discredit a scriptural text, tries to say that it's not real, they're actually in judgment of the scripture. They're actually judging the word of God. They're actually putting themselves above God and judging him. I say that because as we read over in John chapter 1 and verse 1, it says that the word was God. And the way I understand it is saying that the word is God. So when you put yourself in a position that you're judging the word of God, you're actually judging God himself. But anyway, let's get on with this video, proving that the Book of Jubilees was correct and how it says that Noah was shut in the ark on the evening of the 17th. One of the main things that he used to make that argument was in the next verse, how it says that the water poured down from the heaven for 40 days and 40 nights. I'll say it again. If you're searching for errors, you're going to find it. You're not going to see the truth. And all this is saying is that while Noah had been shut up in the ark on the evening of the 17th, the rains didn't actually start until the daylight hours of the 17th. And because he's simply looking at this verse here that mentions the word days before it mentions the words nights, he's making an assumption there. The assumption is that since the word day is listed before night, that somehow means that that 24-hour period that we call the day actually starts with sunrise or in the daylight hours. Now, that's a very juvenile argument because you look in this same verse in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5, it's mentioning the light of day before the darkness of night. But then it goes on to state that and the evening and the morning were the first day, telling us that the 24-hour period that we call the day actually starts at sunset. And my point is that just because the day is mentioned before the night doesn't mean that the day starts with the light and contradicts what the scripture is saying when it says, and the evening and the morning were the first day. To prove that that argument is completely invalid, I could use Joshua chapter 24 and verse 4 as it's talking about Jacob and Esau. You see how it says, and I gave unto Isaac Jacob and Esau, clearly listing Jacob first. It does the same thing over in the book of Romans chapter 9 and verse 13 when it says, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. And in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 20 when it says, by faith Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. It's clearly listing Jacob before it lists Esau. So does that mean that Jacob was born first? Of course not. As we know from the book of Genesis chapter 25, that Esau was actually born first. And even though Jacob is mentioned first in many, many verses, he was actually the younger brother and came second. This proves that the scripture mentioning the day before the night doesn't mean that the morning came before the evening. Just like we see in verse 2 of Genesis chapter 4 where it mentions Abel before it mentions Cain. That doesn't mean that Abel was older. Cain was the older brother. But in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 4, we see again that Abel is mentioned first. But now, of course, that's all circumstantial evidence. And to really understand the start of the day, just like the months and the years, we always have to refer to Enoch. The book of Enoch is the final authority on the Father's sacred calendar, period. No other book can take away from the book of Enoch when it comes to marking time and understanding what's being talked about over in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 14. In other words, if you want to understand what it means by let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years, you're going to have to read the book of the luminaries, which is found in about chapter 71 of the book of Enoch. I would go as far as to say that there's no other book in all of scripture that explains how these lights of the firmament divide the days, the nights, the years, and the months. So let's take a look at Enoch's book of the heavenly luminaries to see particularly when the day is supposed to start. Now, I'm going to have to give credit to my YouTube brother over there for his misunderstanding because the translations of the scripture aren't so clear when it comes to the start of the day. And to illustrate this, I've found a website called QBible.com, which gives us the parallel translations of the book of the luminaries. In other words, we can see two separate translations of the book of the luminaries side by side, so that we can see how it is that our brother has made his misunderstanding and what Enoch was actually trying to say as far as the start of the day. So let's drop down here to verse 2. Now, this must be the translation being used by those who try to say that Enoch is declaring that the start of the day starts with the sunrise, because it says, "And this is the first law of the luminaries. The luminary, the sun, has its rising in the eastern portals of the heaven and its setting in the western portals of the heaven." Now, clearly, it doesn't say when the day actually starts, but because it talks about the sun and its rising, before it talks about the setting of the sun, they are assuming that the sunrise comes first. But as we illustrated in the last example, you can't go by that. You can't say just because the sun rising is mentioned before the sun setting that the day starts with the sunrise, but that's actually what they do. If you listen to their videos, they quote this verse and clearly make the assumption that because the sun rising is listed first, that this day starts with the sunrise. But like I say, I'll give credit to those guys, at least partial credit, because this translation is not very clear on the subject. But let's come over and let's look at this other translation over here, because it is actually clear on the subject. It is actually very clear on the subject and tells us when the day actually starts. The first translation that we read was by Charles, and we can look that up to see Charles who. But the translation that we're about to look at now is by Lawrence. Let's see how it states something slightly different. It says, "This is the first law of the luminaries, that the sun and the light arrives at the gates of heaven, which are on the east, and on the west of it, at the western gates." Now, I want to pause here to see who actually recognized the difference in what it's saying here. Verse 2 in the Lawrence translation says, "This is the first law of the luminaries," which is the same as we saw over in the Charles translation. But then it goes on to say, "The sun and the light arrive at the gates of heaven." Now, the Charles translation uses the word portals, which is not that big a deal. But notice how the translators took it upon themselves to write the words eastern portals or eastern gates of heaven, whereas the Lawrence translation just says gates of heaven. But then it goes on to explain these gates, where it says, "which are on the east and on the west of it." Now notice that it's not talking about a rising or a setting at all. It just says that the light of the sun arrives at these gates, with one gate being in the east and the other gate being in the west. But here's the key part right here. After it talks about the gates, it goes back to talking about the sunlight and how it arrives at the western gates of heaven. So what this is saying is that the first law of the luminaries is that the sunlight arrives at the western gates of heaven. In other words, the first law of the luminary is that the sun sets, not the sun rises, that the sun sets in the western gates of heaven. Whereas the Charles translation gave those guys wiggle room by mentioning the sunrise first. The Lawrence translation makes it clear that the day starts as the sunlight arrives at the western gates at sunset. Now, I know what those guys are going to do. They're going to try to toss out the translation by Lawrence because it doesn't match what they're saying, since it's clearly saying that the day starts with the sunset and doesn't agree with what they believe. They're going to say that it is corrupted. So, to get ahead of them and that argument, I went in and looked it up. Turns out his name was Richard Lawrence, and he translated the Book of Enoch in 1883. The other guy's name was R.H. Charles, and he translated the Book of Enoch in 1917. So that would explain why the Lawrence translation is included in the Apocrypha instead of the Charles translation. So not only is the Lawrence translation more clear and more popular, it's actually been in existence for a longer period of time. But I know that's not going to matter to these guys. They're still going to try to discount it anyway. So let's go on and show even more proof from the King James Version that confirms what Jubilees and Enoch says about the day starting with the sunset. You say, well, why is this so important? The main reason why this is so important is because if you don't understand the correct beginning of the day, you will actually get your days wrong. In other words, your Sabbath days will be off by one day. You will miss the new moon altogether, and you will celebrate the feast days on the wrong day. You see over here in Psalms in chapter 81 and verse 2, where it says that we're supposed to blow the trumpet in the new moon. So if it were true that the day actually started in the morning time, we would be breaking this ordinance and not blowing the trumpet in the new moon, because the daylight hours would actually be over by the time we ever knew that the new moon was actually taking place. And not only will we not be blowing the trumpet on the new moon day, but we'd actually be missing that special time of the new moon when the inner courts are open to our spiritual tabernacle. This is why you often hear me say that anybody who actually tries to keep these feast days correctly will know for sure that the evening time starts the day, because it's almost impossible to keep the Sabbath day or the new moon day if it didn't. Going back to the Book of Jubilees, which is the book that gives us the most detail about the Sabbath days, it is actually Jubilees chapter 50 that talks about the Sabbath day and the laws of the Jubilees. It tells us how we're not allowed to cook on the Sabbath day. You see right there in verse 9 where it's talking about how you have to prepare ahead of time on the sixth day what it is you shall eat. So think about that for a moment. If the Sabbath day started in the morning time, you would have actually had to cook enough food to last for 48 hours on the sixth day, or you would have had to have waken up in the wee hours of the morning before the Sabbath day started and cooked enough food to last for 24 hours, in the dark, no less. For those people who keep the Sabbath day correctly and who know that the day starts in the evening time, it makes sense you would spend all of the daylight hours of the sixth day preparing your meals, so that at sunset you would be able to enjoy the fruits of your labor. And you wouldn't have to wake up in the wee hours of the morning to light your fires and to draw your water and to do all of your other chores trying to get ahead of the Sabbath day. No. Our Father, in His infinite wisdom, gave us the daylight hours of the sixth day in order to prepare and do everything that we needed to do before sunset and the Sabbath day actually started. Well, what about Rosh Hashanah? Let's take a look at it. So we could come over and we can Google Rosh Hashanah 2020, and it will show us the time in which the memorial of blowing of trumpets was to start last year in the year 2020. We see how it says it starts on the evening of September the 18th. This again is more evidence that the evening starts the day, on how every feast day actually starts in the evening time. It shouldn't make sense to anybody that the feast days would start in the evening time while the regular days started in the morning. How confusing would that be? But anyway, that's not the case. All feast days start in the evening time, including the memorial of blowing of trumpets. So let's look at this feast day a little more closely, because it actually falls on the first day of the month at the sighting of the new moon. Now we can look in Leviticus 23 and we can see that the memorial of blowing of trumpets was actually supposed to start on the first day of the month. And thanks to a website called renewedmoon.com, we could actually go back in time and see that the sighting of the new moon was confirmed on the evening of the 18th. So we put those three things together. The memorial of blowing the trumpets was supposed to start on the first day of the first month, and we see that it started on the evening of September the 18th of the year 2020, which coincides with the sighting of the new moon on September the 18th of 2020. This confirms that not only does the month start with the new moon, but it actually starts in the evening. But anybody who does not recognize those two facts would actually not only miss the day of the memorial of blowing of trumpets, but they would actually celebrate the Day of Atonement on the wrong day and the Feast of Tabernacles on the wrong day as well. In other words, they will be celebrating those feast days a day early and a day late, and they will also be celebrating the Sabbath day a day early or a day late. But anyway, let's go on with some more proof. For the next proof, we want to jump over to Nehemiah chapter 13, verses 19 through 22. Verse 19 says, "And it came to pass that when the gates of Jerusalem began to be dark before the Sabbath, I commanded that the gates be shut and charged that they should not be opened until after the Sabbath. And some of my servants sat at the gates that there should be no burden be brought in on the Sabbath day." See how it's saying here that the Sabbath day started as it began to become dark? It was only when it began to be dark did he command that the gates be shut and that they not be opened until after the Sabbath day. And of course, the Sabbath day lasts 24 hours. That would be from dark to dark or from dusk to dusk. Now look at verse 20 right there where it says, "And the merchants and sellers of all kinds of ware lodged without Jerusalem once or twice." These are people who are waiting outside the gates of Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, waiting for the Sabbath day to be over so that they can start buying or selling again. Think about that for a second. If the Sabbath day started in the morning time, wouldn't these people be waiting out there in the dark wee hours of the morning, waiting to sell? Why would it be so important for them to get there before sunrise to start selling? Why wouldn't they just wait till the day had started good, after breakfast maybe, to come and to start doing their buying or selling? What happened was these merchants came to Jerusalem not aware that there was going to be a Sabbath day on a day that they showed up, found the gates shut, and instead of going home with all of their wares and goods, they knew that all that they had to do was just wait till the sun went down, and then they would have been able to sell their goods. So that's what they did, proving that the Sabbath day ended at sunset, just like it began the day before. But anyway, let's go on. I got more proof. So let's come over here to Matthew chapter 28, which is another passage that many people who want to discredit Genesis, who says that the day starts in the evening time, and all of the other verses and books that say that the day starts in the evening time will use to support their argument. And that's when Mary Magdalene and the mother of the Messiah came to the sepulchre and found it empty. You see how it says in verse 28, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre." So this is another argument that they use, that the day has to start in the daylight hours, because Mary and Mary came to the sepulchre in the morning time at dawn. And to these people, because the 24-hour period that we call the day starts in the evening time, that would mean that Mary and Mary would have actually went to the sepulchre at the evening time or in the night time. But you have to remember, these people didn't have flashlights. They didn't do a lot of stuff at night at all during that time. You really expect them to go into the tomb, what we would call a graveyard, in the nighttime? No. It shouldn't be too hard to understand that even though the Sabbath day ended the evening before, they would have still waited to the morning time in order to come to the sepulcher. But they still use this verse to support their argument. See how it says, end of the Sabbath as it began to dawn? So in their minds, they want to understand that the Sabbath day was ending at dawn. And like we said at the beginning of this video, if you search the scripture trying to find lies, you will find it. Your brain or your ego will prevent you from reading the rest of this verse and seeing how it says the first day of the week. This dawn in which they were coming to the sepulcher was the first day of the week. And your ego will also prevent you from going over to the book of Mark and reading the same account where it's actually made more clear. You see how in verse 1 of chapter 16 of Mark it says, when the Sabbath was passed, Mary and Mary brought sweet spices that they might anoint him. Well, this is talking about how the Sabbath day was completely over. But then when you look at verse 2, it says, and very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. So whereas the Sabbath day ended the evening before, and they've waited about 12 hours to come at dawn, that was actually on the first day of the week. Because the first day of the week started the evening after the Sabbath day had ended. And that's the way it works every month. The Sabbath day ends in the evening time, and then the first day of the week begins. And like I said earlier, anybody who pays attention to the Sabbath day and attempts to do it correctly will be convinced that the Sabbath day has to start and end in the evening time, or it will be impossible to keep. Now, another verse I'll show you is over here in John in chapter 20, which is talking about the same story and how it says the first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. This is telling us that the first day had actually started before the sun came up. This is proof that the first day of the week started before the sun came up. This is proof that every day of the week starts before the sun comes up. See how it says, and yet dark? Yet it was still dark? It was still dark. But yet they're already on the first day of the week. That's because the day started at sunset. Every day starts at sunset. The evening and the morning is what constitutes the day. We need to stop trying to disprove the Bible and to think that somehow these scriptures are in error. The Word of God is perfect. It is our own understanding that's flawed. And if our ego doesn't let us see that, we will go on to try to disprove the scripture in order to make ourselves look correct. Putting ourselves in judgment of the Word of God, even putting ourselves above the Father as we discredit the Word of God. But like we read over in the book of Romans, chapter 3 and verse 4, it says, let God be true and every man a liar. So if you try to disprove the Bible in any way, shape or form, you will be made a liar out of. If you go to the scripture trying to find lies, you're going to find it. And you're going to find strong delusion.